Thank you very much. So first, let me thank the organizers for organizing this nice conference and inviting me. And thanks to all of you for being here. So in my talk today, I will talk about some partition identities and their connection to infinite dimensional Lie algebras and also crystal bases. So initially, this talk didn't have a lot of asymptotic in it. It's definitely algebraic combinatorics, but not so much asymptotic. But because I took the title of the conference very seriously, I tried to squeeze in a bit of asymptotics of partition in the talk. So you will see. So the talk will be as follows. So I will start with an introduction of partition identities coming from representation theory. And then I will introduce a new infinite family of partition identities, which I proved with my co-author Isaac Conant. And we will see the connections with representation theory and crystal bases. And I will conclude with another generalization of another classical partition identity from representation theory. And if time permits, I will show a bijection between those two identities. So we've seen already many partitions this week, but they were mostly presented as Young diagrams. So in my talk, partitions will be more seen as non-increasing sequences of integers, which are called the parts of the partitions. And for my partition identities, there will be some conditions on these parts. And we will try to compute a lot of generating functions. So let me recall some little things about generating functions for partitions. So first of all, this notation will come a lot in this talk. It's called the Q-Pochhammer notation. And it's a short way to write the product for k from 0 to n minus 1 of 1 minus aq to the k. And as several of you probably already know, if you want to compute the generating function for partitions into distinct parts, where the power of q counts the number that is partitioned and the power of z counts the number of parts, then you can write this very concisely as this infinite product, because for each number, let's say 3 here, we decide whether it appears in the partition, which will give us a coefficient zq to the 3, or if it doesn't, which gives you a 1. And by taking the product over all integers, you get this nice product. And in a very similar way, if you do not want the parts to be distinct, but they can be anything, you can also compute the generating function for partitions very easily by using a similar reasoning. So over all positive integers, you choose the number of times that this number appears in the partition. And by simplifying, you can also write this very concisely. So those two little reasonings I explained here, you can do exactly the same if you want to restrict yourselves to partitions that have some determined congruence conditions. So instead of multiplying over all positive integers, you can multiply over all positive integers that are congruent to k modulo n. And you obtain, with exactly the same reasoning, this generating function for partitions into distinct parts, and this one for partitions into general parts without restrictions. And in partition identities, what we often do is show that partitions satisfying some difference conditions between two consecutive parts have the same cardinality as partitions satisfying some congruence conditions. So we will compute a lot of generating functions. And the goal in the end will be to show that it has a shape like this, which is the most general shape of partition of generating functions for partitions with congruence conditions. So not only the advantage is that it has a nice concise shape, but also, if you care about asymptotics, as many people do in this room, when you can write a generating function for partitions as an infinite product, there is also a very good consequence of this, which is that you can compute asymptotics fairly easily by using the circle method, which was introduced by Hardy and Ramanujan at the beginning of the 20th century. So I will just explain in one slide very generally and quickly what the idea of this circle method is. So first of all, the initial idea of the method is to write, so here I do it on the example of classical partitions. So we did not by P of n the number of partitions of n. And by using the Cauchy formula of complex analysis, you can write P of n as an integral over a circle with radius less than 1 of its generating function, which is here in the denominator, times a certain power of q. And so you integrate this generating function on your circle. So why do we need to take a radius less than 1? It's because our generating function here has many singularities on the unit circle, actually even infinitely many, which is not very convenient. So you cannot cross the circle in any way with your contour, or you will have big problems. So you need to stay inside. And then the idea of the circle method is to make your circle grow and go closer and closer to the unit circle so that you can get closer to the behavior of the singularities. And the other key ingredient is the fact that our infinite products, all of those that I showed before, they can be written by using the Dedekind eta function, which is a modular form and has nice transformation properties. So Dan spoke a bit about modular forms before. So the transformation properties make it easier to study this function asymptotically. And by using this fact, you can show, you can get an estimate on a small portion of the circle around 1. And you can also get an upper bound on the rest of the circle. And you show that the asymptotic contribution around 1 dominates the rest of the asymptotic contribution. And that's how you get the super nice formula here, which is more or less an exponential of square root of n times some constant. OK, and if you do the asymptotics of partition with some other congruence conditions, you will have different things in front of the exponential and different constants here, but it's always like exponential something times square root of n. So now let's see our first example of partition identities. So first of all, right now it looks more like Q-series identities. So here we have an infinite sum equals an infinite product. For the infinite product, if you listen well until now, you will know that this corresponds to partitions into parts congruent to 1 or 4 modulo 5. And here, this infinite sum will count partitions where parts differ by where consecutive parts, sorry, differ by at least 2. So why is that? It's because you can say that n squared, you can write it as 1 plus 3, etc., plus 2n minus 1. So this is a partition where you have difference exactly 2. And to this partition, you can add any other partition, let's say whatever, 7 plus 7 plus 3, for example. So, and if you add the biggest part here with this one, etc., etc., the partition that you obtain will have difference at least 2. And this is how you can translate these Q-series identities into a partition identity. So, to make the connection with what I said before, so again, you can do the circle method on this infinite product. And as I told you, you get something slightly different here, but also always something that is exponential in a constant times square root n. And there is a second Roche just Ramanujan identity, which is pretty similar, except that here you add some plus n. And here, instead of being 1 or 4 modulo 5, you have 2 or 3 modulo 5. And in terms of difference conditions, it's the same. But now we have the added condition that the smallest part is at least 2. It's just because you do exactly the same reasoning, but you do 2 plus 4, etc., up to 2n. So it only changes the value of the smallest part. And again, you have similar asymptotics, except that before you had no 2 here, and now we have a 2. And so today we will study the connections with those partition identities and representation theory. So I will not go too much into detail in all the definitions on the algebras, but just one or two very simple ones so that you know the objects we are working on. So if you consider a finite dimensional simple Lie algebra G, there is a way to construct the affine version of this Lie algebra by taking the tensor product with the Laurent polynomials and adding also a center. And this center will be important because it's one dimensional. So if you take a representation V of your affine Lie algebra G hat, then the center acts like a multiplication by a scalar, and this scalar will be called the level of the representation. And you will see in the remainder of the talk, I will use the word level many times. So now it's defined. And there is another important object for our study, which is the character of this irreducible module. So some of you might have heard other talks where I spoke about characters, but they were not the same characters. So pay attention at the definition. So this character is simply defined as the sum of the dimensions of V mu times exponential mu, where mu are all the weights of V. So you can decompose V as a sum of weight spaces V mu. And so that's how you construct your character. And now that we have defined this object, I hope we can more or less understand how we will relate things with representation theory. So the story of the connection with representation theory started in the 1980s when Lebowski and Wilson, two representation theorists, gave an interpretation and a new proof of the Rogers-Ramanujan identities by using the character formula that I just gave on the previous slide for irreducible highest weight A11 modules of level 3. So A11 is the same as SL2 hat for those who prefer talking about with SLNs than ANs. And so they don't only take the character formula, but they make a principal specialization in it. So if you multiply by exponential minus lambda, where lambda is the highest weight, your character, it can be written as a series in exponential minus alpha I, where alpha I are the simple roots. And if you send all the exponential minus alpha I to Q, that's what is called the principal specialization. So what they did is that they wrote this character in two different ways. So one way to get the infinite product here, multiplied by this factor, is to use the Weilkatz character formula. So it's a formula which in general can seem slightly complicated, but they were able to make it look like a nice product by using this nice principal specialization. And on the other side, for the sum side, actually they constructed a basis of their representation. And this is how they get the difference conditions. So if I can explain very vaguely the idea, I'm not claiming to give all the details. They start with a spanning set of their Lie algebra module. So let's say, by simplifying a little bit, that it's the monomials in the variable x1, x2, etc. And then by using Lie theory, they have some relations on those monomials, which will allow them to remove some of them. So, for example, let's say if you have xi squared, it's a bit more complicated than that, but let's say it's going to be replaced by xi plus 1, xi minus 1. So that way you get rid of all the xi's that repeat, which is equivalent to getting rid of all the parts that repeat in the partition. And you will have another rule: if you have xi plus 1, xi, you can also replace that with something that will contain something with difference at least 2. And then the hardest part of the work is showing that this is actually a basis. So they were able to do it in their case, but as we may see later. In some other cases, it's hard to show that it's a basis. So many other representation theorists followed a little bit the same techniques. And yes?
When you say that they give a new interpretation in terms of the algebra, do you mean that that also gives a new proof?
Yes. Yeah. What they do is sufficient to prove the theorem, yes. But it's not a short proof. It's like, I think, if I remember, it's 80 pages. Or it's like rather complicated, but it's a proof. Yes. And so, OK, for Rogers Ramanujan, we already knew the identities. So maybe one can think, why give a 80-page proof of something that can be proved more quickly? Well, yes, that's true. But if you apply it to some other Lie algebras, then you discover new identities. So all these guys proved new identities that the combinatorialists didn't know about by studying other modules of other Lie algebras or the same Lie algebra but at other levels. Every time it gives a new partition identity. So in all these cases, the product side is always relatively simple to get. You use the Wildcat's character formula. You do principal specialization. But in all this, what is hard to do is to get the sum side by finding a basis. So they often have a conjecture for a basis, but they are not able to show that the family is free. So it's often conjectural. Sometimes it's proved, but it depends. But that's where combinatorics can come into play, because if you are able to prove the corresponding identity combinatorially, then you have equality of cardinalities. And therefore, your generating family, which has also the right cardinality, is a basis. So you can start the work representation theoretically and finish it. Caparelli, who was a student of Lepovsky. And so he studied the level 3 standard modules of A22, so another Lie algebra, but still level 3. And he got a partition identity that was previously unknown to combinatorialists. The details are maybe not that important. What is important is that, again, on one side, you have congruence conditions, so an infinite product, nice modular properties, etc. And on the other side, you have difference conditions between consecutive parts. And actually, this theorem, there is a fun story about this. So it was first the conjecture of Caparelli. And Lepovsky presented the conjecture at a conference where George Andrews, who is like the greatest specialist of partition identities, probably, was in the audience. And I guess the conjecture was presented around the beginning of the conference, let's say on Monday, but I wasn't there. And Andrews was set to speak at the end of the conference, let's say on Friday. And he had given an abstract, a title, etc. But when he arrived at the blackboard, the title had changed, and it was proof of the Caparelli conjecture. So Andrews, in a week, was able to prove combinatorially something that was actually quite hard to prove representation theoretically, because you had to wait 2 more years before Caparelli and also Tambay-Anxier were able to prove it with representation theory only. And what I want to present now is not exactly a proof of Caparelli's identity, but a proof of a refinement of Caparelli's identity, which is done through the method of weighted words. So this method was originally invented by Aladi and Gordon to give a refinement of Schur's theorem. But we will see it on the example of Caparelli. So instead of considering the classical integers, we will now consider colored integers. And we give an order on them. So here we will have colors A, C, and D. You first order the numbers and then the letters lexicographically. There is no B, but it's not because I have forgotten. It's because, you will see soon. There will be a B in Prim's identity. And you give some difference conditions satisfied by these colored integers, which you can write in a matrix, for example. So the fact that there is a 1 here means that if you have a part colored C followed by a part colored A, then the difference between the two is at least 1. And you choose those difference conditions so that when you do some transformations here that I call dilations, then those difference conditions should become exactly those of Caparelli's identity. And the idea is to show that the generating function for these colored partitions is an infinite product. So the idea of the original method of Aladi, Andrews, and Gordon is to compute directly. I put some quotation marks because it's not like it's completely obvious. It takes some work, but still, compute directly the generating function for those partitions with difference conditions as an infinite sum. And then they use some Q-series transformations to rewrite this as an infinite product. And actually, here, for example, the power of A counts the number of integers of color A, the same for C and D. And actually, if you keep track of all the color variables, you cannot get an infinite product. You will need to set C equals 1, which means that we cannot keep track of the number of parts colored C. And in that case, you can get an infinite product like this. So again, this corresponds to congruence conditions. Yes? Yeah, it's both a color and a variable counting the number of parts of this color. So I hope it's not too confusing. So they get a non-dilated version of the identity. And if you do some transformations on the variables which correspond to the transformations of uncolored integers that I presented before, then this becomes exactly Caparelli's identity. And the advantage is that you can make whatever other dilations that you want, and you will get new partition identities for free. And also, it gives more intuition about the combinatorics of these partitions.
Can you interpret this formula as an identity, sort of a super identity?
This one? Yeah, it's like a refined identity, if you want. It's a colored partition identities. So here you have a partition with difference conditions that were given by the matrix I showed before, and here you have congruence conditions.
So you're saying that Caparelli's identity and a bunch of others are sort of like projections of this?
Yes. Yeah, or specializations, or yeah, exactly. Yeah. So that's the idea of the method of weighted worlds, and in general, we prefer proving partition and identities in this refined way with the color variables because it has more information. So what we will do in this talk will also be proving some partition identities with colors. So our starting point is Primes identity, which comes from crystal basis of the affine Lie algebra A11. So I will go into details about crystal basis a bit later. So far I'm sticking mostly to combinatorics. And the identity is as follows. So now you take four colors. I didn't forget the B this time. And again, you have some difference conditions, which actually comes from the energy function of the crystal. And Primes conjectured that after you do those dilations, which correspond to the principal specialization in the Lie algebra, the generating function for these partitions becomes 1 over QQ infinity. So this was later proved by myself and Jeremy Lovejoy. And actually, instead of proving the dilated version that Primes conjectured, we proved a version where we could keep three of the four colors, so we can keep track of A, C, and D. And this was proved by using a variant of the method of weighted worlds, where instead of computing directly the generating function, we use Q difference equations and recurrences. And the thing is, in the same paper of Primes, he studied also crystal bases of another crystal, A21, which has a slightly larger matrix. And he proved this time, not conjectured, that if you do the principal specialization in the generating function for partitions satisfying these difference conditions, that actually the generating function is again something quite simple. which can be surprising when you look at this complicated matrix. But there was no combinatorial explanation of this result. So that's what we wanted to tackle with my colleague, Isaac. And in the same paper, there was another big matrix. So the previous one was 9 by 9. This one is 8 by 8. And again, we have complicated difference conditions. And if you do the principal specialization, you get again something quite simple. There is a factor here on top, but again, relatively simple. So we wanted to understand, if possible, those two matrices. And actually, we did slightly better because we were able to embed both of them in infinite families of identities. So we will see the first one, which generalizes Prim's identity. So we will define some new types of colors. So we take just two sequences of symbols. One are the ANs, the other one the BNs. And we define first the set of what we call free colors. It's colors AI, BI, so the same index. And we have bound colors, which are AI, BK, for K different from I. And we define some general difference conditions between, so the minimal difference between a part colored AI, BK and a part colored A prime, BK prime, is the following definition, where those k's are equal to 1 if what is inside is true and 0 otherwise. And we define Pn to be the set of partitions satisfying these difference conditions, and such that the indices of our colors are between 0 and n minus 1. So, for example, the primes, the relatively simple primes that we studied before, this one, it corresponds to P2. So we take our differences, but we restrict the indices to 0 or 1. And the color correspondence are the following. And the big matrix 9 by 9 that I showed before, that's P3. And of course, we also have Pn for general n. And we will show an identity with those general Pns.
So did Grimch know that his table can be represented in that way?
This formula?
Yeah.
No, that's new. That's new. Yeah. That's the starting point of our paper, yeah, and Primch didn't know. So I told you before that usually when you do partition identities, you relate partition with difference conditions with partition with congruence conditions. Here we are going to be a little bit original because we will relate them to a generalization of Frobenius partitions instead. So classical Frobenius partitions are quite simple. You just take two-line array like this, where each line is a partition into distinct non-negative parts. And these partitions can be proved to be in bijection with classical partitions because, if we consider that the number partitioned by this is s plus the sum of lambda i's plus the sum of mu i's, then you can put s boxes on the diagonal and put the parts of lambda like this and mu like that. And you will see that this is in bijection with Young diagrams. So Frobenius partitions are the same as classical partitions. But what we study here is not exactly Frobenius partitions, but colored Frobenius partitions. So it's a bit of a similar principle. But instead of having just two partitions into distinct parts, we have colored partitions into distinct parts. And you can notice here the order is different on the top row and the bottom row. So here we start, the smallest is color an minus 1, and the biggest is color a0. And here it's the contrary, the smallest is b0, and the largest is bn minus 1. And we will call these colored Frobenius partitions n-squared colored Frobenius partitions. And we can define a color sequence for those colored Frobenius partitions in a quite simple way, which is that we will take the color of lambda 1 and the color of mu 1. So this will give you something of the type A sub I, B sub K. So the same types of colors as we had for primes, generalized partitions. And yeah, so by using a similar reasoning as to compute the generating function for the classical Frobenius partitions, we can show that the generating function for colored Frobenius partitions is actually the coefficient of x0 in an infinite product like this. And our goal was to show then that to give a connection between the primes generalized partition and those n squared colored Frobenius partitions. And to do this, we had to introduce a new notion, which was the one of reduced colored sequence. So if you start with a sequence of colors of the form AIBK, then we can define a reduction operation. The principle is that if you have a color, a bound color AKBL followed by a free color ALBL, you can remove ALBL. And the same, if you have a free color AKBK before a bound color AKBL, you remove also AKBK. And what you obtain at the end, once you cannot reduce anymore, is called a reduced colored sequence. So here, for example, I did this process on this example. So yes, here, for example, this A2B2 disappeared because it's after A1B2. And the same for the other ones. And actually, the link between the primes partitions and the colored Frobenius partitions is that if you take a certain reduced colored sequence, then you will have the same number of primes generalized partitions having this reduced colored sequence as you have colored Frobenius partitions with the same reduced colored sequence. And the proof is done by doing some Q-series manipulations and by studying carefully how the minimal difference conditions evolve when you add some free color in your reduced color sequence. And therefore, we get a partition identity that generalizes a primes identity. So here we have a generalized primes partition. Actually, to be able to write it as a nice infinite product like this, we need to set the variables ai equal to bi minus 1 for some technical reason. So we end up with an identity where we are able to keep track of n more variables, the bi's. So remember, what Primes used to prove or conjecture in his paper was that when you do the principal specialization, you get this nice, this simple generating function for just the one for partitions. So this is true here because the generating function we get here is the following. So after doing the principal specialization, that's what we obtain. And here you have all the possible values of like we have all the n minus i's for I to from 0 to n minus 1. So in the end, this can just reduce as this product. And we saw before, so that was just classical Frobenius partitions. And we said they are in bijection with partitions. So we obtain also this generating function. Yes. So those partitions with those complicated difference conditions, if you do those transformations, which are also equivalent to doing some transformation on colored integers, yeah. So those partitions are in bijection with classical partitions.
Yeah, but I mean, is there a sort of a simple description?
We don't have a bijection so far. No.
Is there a simple description of what that class is?
Well, simple depends what you mean, but like
you can
express it with this difference condition delta that I gave.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you can do the principal specialization in delta, and
I'm just wondering if it became simpler once you do that
Not really, no, rather more complicated, I would say. I mean, because then if you want to... Yeah, having a bijection would be very interesting, but we haven't managed so far. Maybe someday we are trying to think of it. But yeah, so far it's not clear exactly how we could get a bijection. So again, a tiny bit of asymptotics. So actually, in 1984, Andrews studied some types of colored Frobenius partitions, but a bit different from ours because he did not keep track of the colors. So it was like just a, yeah. It was still colored partitions, but in the generating function, you just had one variable, q, not keeping track of the colors. And Andrews computed the asymptotics, and again, you had some exponential of square root of m, because now the integer that is partitioned is called m, and n, if you remember, is the number of colors. And so here I wrote also the number of classical partitions, and you notice they are super similar, except that there is an n here. But that's actually quite logical, because in the principal specialization, you transform q by q to the n. So more or less, it's like multiplying asymptotically all the integers by n. So it makes sense that here it also multiplies m by n. And again, if you're interested in the asymptotic of Primes partition for any reason, the fact that we are able to express them with Frobenius partitions makes the asymptotics much easier to compute. I wouldn't have known how to do it with like just the difference conditions. Okay. So, also, we were able to find a big formula to express this generating function for the n squared colored Frobenius partitions as a sum of infinite products, which all have obviously positive coefficients. So, it's like writing this as a sum of other partition generating functions, like partition into distinct parts. And that will be useful, for example, to get a new formula for the character of the AN1 module of level 1. Or also, if you want to do congruences, for example, some people in partition theory like to do congruences, it can be useful for them because it's not only good for asymptotics when you have infinite products like this, it's also good to find congruences by using the modular properties of these infinite products. Okay, so now let's go back to representation theory. So I promised that I would tell a little bit more detail about crystals. So I must admit I cannot introduce crystals in whole details, like with all the definitions, because for those of you who know them already, you may know that it's quite long and intricate. So I will just try to give you the idea for those who don't know. So crystals can be seen as a combinatorial way to represent Lie algebra representations by doing some graphs like this. So for example, the crystal for the vector representation of an minus 1, 1 is this graph. And you can also compute the dual of any crystal graph simply by reversing the edges. So that's quite simple. And if B is a crystal, then the dual is also a crystal of the same representation. And then there is also a very nice property in crystals, is that if you have two different crystals of two representations, M1 and M2, then there is a way to define a tensor product of those two crystals, and that will give you a crystal for the tensor product of the two representations. So here, for example, so these are the rules, because here you saw, so for example, if you have an edge here between 0 and 1, you encode this by saying that f1 of 0, f1 tilde of 0 is 1. And so in this way, you can get, by satisfying certain rules, you can get how to construct your crystal. So for example, if we take a11, so the crystal of the vector representation is quite simple, it's this one. And if you want to take the tensor of B and its dual, for example, so let's see, for example, what happens with this vertex. So we have a vertex 0, 1. And so we want to know where to go with the edge 1 from this vertex. So we look at f tilde 1 of 0, 1. And so phi I is phi 1 of 0 is 1 because you can only do one move with an edge 1 going out of 0. And the epsilon I of b2 in the dual is actually the same as phi 1 of b2 in the graph. So nothing exceeds from 1 with a 1. So this is 0. So we are in the first case. So that means that with one edge, you will go from 0, 1 to f1 of 0, which is 1, times 1. So you go here. So you see, like it's a rule. Maybe if it's the first time you're seeing it, maybe it might seem a bit complicated to understand. But it's really like an automatic thing. You just have to look at your crystal and satisfy those conditions. So yes, you get this nice crystal, which again, still corresponds to a representation of A11. And there is one more definition, which is the energy. So you can define an energy on those crystals, which is a map from the tensor product of the crystal with itself to the integers. And again, it follows some rules. And you can notice here that actually it's only the zero arrows that will play a role in the computation of the energy function. So that can be useful for later. And so the two matrices of Primst, he obtained them by studying the energy function in crystals for A11 and A21. So we can wonder if by any chance the difference conditions delta that we defined are also related to an energy function of a crystal. And because I'm making these slides, you can guess the answer. Yes. So here, actually, so you recognize the delta that we defined before, those difference conditions. Well, they exactly correspond to the energy function of the tensor product of the vector representation of an minus 1. One and its dual. When you fix the fact that for the vertex with all zeros, the value of the energy function is zero, because actually you always have to fix a value in each connected component of your crystal to compute the energy function. So this gives a new and simple formula for the energy function of this crystal. There was previously, in 2006, a paper by Benkert, Frankel, Kang, and Lee, who also computed the energy function on the same crystal, but not as explicitly. They were using the fact that indeed the energy function only varies when you encounter a zero arrow. So they removed all zero arrows and said that on each connected component, the energy function is constant. And they gave an example of a vertex of each connected component. But if you give me some arbitrary LK, L prime, K prime, it's not easy, obviously, to see in which connected component that is. Whereas here, with this formula that we gave before, you just have a small computation to do, just a general formula. So we are also able, by using the KMN squared character formula, so KMN squared stands for Kang, Kashiwara, Misra, Miwa, Nakashima, and Nakayashiki. I'm sure Igor is pleased by the KMN squared acronym. But so their character formula more or less expresses again the character that I defined at the beginning of the talk as a generating function of something involving the energy function. So by using the previous result on the energy function and our new formula for those colored Frobenius partitions, we are able to give a new formula for the character with obviously positive coefficients as a series in the exponential minus alpha I, where the alpha I's are the simple roots of the Lie algebra, which is also quite nice because by definition those characters are supposed to be series with positive coefficients, but it's not always easy to find an explicit formula. So I must also mention a previous result of Katz and Peterson, who found also some character formula with positive coefficients. And actually, from our result, we can also recover their results by giving another expression for the generating function for those Frobenius colored partitions. And but yeah, so we have two different formulas. The new one being maybe even more obviously positive because it's a sum of obviously positive things and maybe more related to partitions. And in the last 5 minutes, I will tell you quickly the connection with Schiaparelli's identity, but I think I will probably not have time for the bijection, at least not in detail, but I warned you that this might happen. So let's go back to the original Primes identity and the original Schiaparelli's identity, both in non-dilated versions with the colors. So if you look at those two matrices, well, both have zeros, ones, and twos. That's a similarity, but apart from that, maybe nothing jumps into your eyes like this. But if you look at the generating function, actually here you might start to find that they look a little bit like each other. So basically the generating function for Primes is almost the same as the one for Schiaparelli after you multiply by QQ. And also you cannot keep track of the C here on that side. But they look quite similar. So one might think that by looking at this that there might be some connection between the two. And this is what I proved recently. So I actually gave a bijection between partition pairs lambda mu, where lambda is a Schiaparelli partition and mu is just some classical partition, colored B or C, actually, doesn't matter. And a bijection between those pairs of partitions and four colored Primes partitions, which then explain the connection between those two identities. So with my colleague, we also wanted to know if this could also be generalized and if we could find some AN1 version of Schiaparelli also. And this is true. So we were able to find two different families of identities generalizing Schiaparelli. Actually, there are even more than two if you want, but those two are the easiest to state, so here they are. So basically, you start with the same differences as the Primes partition with this big delta, and in some cases, you make some small modifications. In those cases, delta was zero, but big delta was zero, but small delta becomes one. And you also have to forbid some additional patterns of length 3, except for n equals 2, in which case you don't have forbidden patterns. And there is another family. Again, the conditions are a bit different, but the principle is the same. Some zeros in big delta become ones in small delta. And we are also able to give a partition between pairs of partition lambda mu, where lambda is in one of those new families I just described, and mu is just a classical partition. So In that way, we can also prove that when you do the principal specialization, for example, you have the formula that prime choice saying, and yeah, and you have the generalization for this for all n in type an minus 1, 1. And yeah, I think I don't have time to give the bijection, which was there, so I will just thank you for your attention.